No, 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 no plugging, no plugging, nothing. Respected chair, esteemed Professor Samten and distinguished participants in this event. Professor Rupa Bandopadhyaya gave a very brilliant exposition of the concept of mind according to Advaita Vedanta. And I would just add a few notes. And I have taken 10 minutes, I have asked 5 to 10 minutes to discuss about the concept of mind which she could not explore in her presentation. And friends, this concept of mind as it is available in Indian philosophical thinking is it is a museum of ideas about the concept of mind. And Advaita Vedanta especially has dealt with this concept in a very in-depth level and going from one end to the other end as to how the knowledge is gained and what is the role of mind. It has dealt with all types of philosophical hermeneutics explaining how a man in the world who has the mind and a man out of the world, a jivan mukta who has the mind, the role of the mind differs, but mind remains in both the states, in both the in jivan mukta and a person who is in the world baddha. Friends, I would like to start with Rupaji's my response to Rupaji's title of the paper, that is Mind and Individual Ego. Madam, I would like to say individual ego is also mind. In generic sense, mind is understood as mano, buddhi, ahankara, chitta. So you, like, it is better to avoid the second portion of the title, like individual ego, if it is ahankara. That is number one, like individual ego. Why I am telling this is, you have quoted Shankara, Brahadaranyaka Upanishad, tat mano akuruta. In that, Shankara says that karyalochana kshamam manasabda vachyam antakaranam akuruta. He says, so mana and antakarana are synonymously used by Shankaracharya himself. And you have told in one of your slides that mana and antakarana are different. Like, that is something which needs to be, like, you have to tell in case they are different according to Advaita, how they are different. Friends, one problem comes when you discuss about antakarana in Advaita Vedanta, mana in Advaita Vedanta is, you are sandwiched between one side Mahayana Buddhism, another side Samkhya. Because the Samkhya is one of the schools in Indian philosophy which is historicity, history is lost. Even Shankaracharya says in Vipratishedhata Samanjasam, he says, Samkhya is very relevant because, inconsistent because, it talks about a variety of things. History is lost, philosophy cannot be construed. Mahabharata gives some clues to construct the philosophy of Samkhya, but it cannot be. But Advaita Vedanta takes the best out of it, even though it tells that you are Pradhanam Allah. Even though Shankara tries to do away with Samkhya system, Samkhya has influenced Shankara's thinking as much as Mahayana Buddhist have influenced him. Therefore, when you talk about the concept of mind between both, you have to take the both and see where exactly Shankara locates himself in when he is doing the philosophy of Samkhya. Then second thing is, you know, I don't want to get into the other things, but one thing I would like to tell, that what is the relation between, why mind has to be accepted? What is the reason, logic for which mind has to be accepted in Advaita Vedanta, like he was also talking about it. Shankara, like Vidyaranya says, guna dosa upalabdhi anyatha anupapatya tat karanatvena manayeva abhivagantabhyam. Vidyaranya also says, what is the relation between mind and consciousness? Professor Gokhale has brought a very important thing, that whether mind can be like translated as Manas, but we have no other way. Manas is the only thing available that we can translate. But that apart, this what is the relation between consciousness and mind is being discussed elaborately in Vidyaranya. He says that mind is having a natural relationship with the Atman, like Brahman. That is how he tries to, lot of, you know, the Purvapakshas are there, I don't have time to deal with that. One last thing I would like to tell, which, you know, very importantly, that what is the, how is mind important for Advaitin is, the mind is the only source by which a person can become a Jivan Mukta. Mind cannot be disowned by a Jivan Mukta because it is Akhandakara Vritti Rupa. And, jnana, that is being accepted by Advaitin, where he says that when Akhandakara Vritti Rupa Jnana comes, what happens? Mano Nasa takes place. Mind does not remain as the same mind because Khandakara mind, the mind having partite knowledge is different from mind having impartite knowledge, which Mahayana Buddhist again will, you know, get into this problematic. I don't want to get into that. That requires another seminar altogether. Mahesh Devakar will sometimes organize that, and I've told him that how Advaitin and Mahayana and Samkhya are to, you know, dialogue between themselves. Not much work has been done, has to be done that way. Therefore, Akhandakara Vritti, that's why the mind, you know, for pratyaksha, the importance, the primacy of pratyaksha, and Akhandakara Vritti Jnana, Sarvatma Bhava of a Jivan Mukta, everywhere mind plays an important role, which is how the two schools, Vivarana School and Bhavati School, are dialoguing, whether Sabda, whether Upanishadik Vakya, Mahavakya Jnana is important or mind is important. And the finally, you know, largely, they say that Mahavakyartha Jnana Janya Avidya Nivartakam Brahma Jnanam Jivan Muktasya Bhavati. The Jivan Mukta gets the knowledge from the Upanishadic statements through the Akhandakara Vritti Rupa Jnana, and that is what is how Brahma Jnana is explained. So mind has such a vast range of activity from pratyaksha, ordinary, to through illusory, to the suprasensuous, like actionless, naiskarmya jnana, that is Brahma jnana. And therefore, madam, we have to, and again, the mind, when Advaitin does the three states of, Jagrat Supra, Swapana Susupti, what would be the role of, where the mind would be there in Susupti or not? That would be another question to be discussed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Mishra, for your very important and pertinent comments. I start with the title of my presentation, The Mind and the Individual Ego. Is the and redundant? Is it mistaken? Is it incorrect? I'd like to comment on these aspects. First, individual ego, there are also translational problems are always there. I started my presentation just like Professor Gokhale referring to translational problems, that in Indian philosophy, what is meant by manas and antakarana are not the same as what is meant by the mind in the Western tradition following the Cartesian legacy. I said that in my very second slide. Now, here, individual ego, I use this term to mean jiva chaitanya. Let me elaborate on this. Let me elaborate on this problem for 1 or 2 minutes. First one, of course, mono, buddhi, ahankara, chitta are accepted by the Advaita Vedantins as four functions or four aspects of the mind. as Professor Mishra has rightly observed, as it has been stated by Dharmaraja Dwarindra in his Vedanta Paribhasha. Okay, no problem with that. But the individual, what do we mean by the individual in ordinary philosophical parlance? The individual is the individual self. The individual is the jiva. Now, the monas or the antakarana is not the jiva. Then what is the jiva? What is the jiva chaitanya? On the Vivarana view, avidya pratibimbita chaitanya, consciousness reflected in avidya is the jiva chaitanya or the individual self. You may call it the individual ego, you may not. Translational problems are there. I am not going into translational problems because translational problems arise out of cross-cultural interactions. It's not a system intrinsic problem. It's not the problem of the system. Shankara didn't know English. Shankara had no obligation to translate his works into English. That's our problem. That was not Shankara, Prakashatma Yoti, or Vachaspati Mishra's problem. Okay, now that's our problem. We need to tackle that. In any way, we can do it as authentically and as textually as we can. That was not Shankara's or Vachaspati's problem. Now, about the individual self, the Advaita Vedantins differ among themselves regarding the nature of the individual self. The Vivarana school says that jiva or the individual is avidya pratibimbita chaitanya. This view is not upheld by sankshepa sharirako karo. Avidya pratibimbita chaitanya means consciousness reflected in avidya itself. That will lead to the conclusion that there is only one individual. And as a matter of fact, Prakashatma Yoti adheres to the view known as Eko Jivo Vado, that is, there is only one individual. And there is, and the entire universe is created by his drishti. This view is called Drishti Srishti Vado, a cosmic kind of solipsism. This is the esoteric Vivarana view. But other Advaita philosophers like Sarvajnatma Muni, in his Sankhepa Sharirako Tika on Shankara Bhashya, on Shankara's commentary on the Brahma Sutra, he said that jiva is consciousness as reflected in Karyopadhi. Karyopadhi upahita chaitanyam jiva, karanopadhi upahita chaitanyam ishara. In that case, antakarana upahita chaitanya or antakarana pratibimbita chaitanya will become jiva, right? In Vedanta Paribhasha, Dharmaraja has created a lot of problems. Partly he followed the Vivarana tradition and partly he followed Sarvajnatma Muni's teaching. He called antakarana vachinna chaitanya. He used the avachedaka vado, that is consciousness delimited by antakarana jiva chaitanya. So what is happening? Mind and the individual are not remaining the same thing. That is why I use the and. If mind and the individual were the same thing, if I used the individual ego as a translation for just ahankara, which is simply a facet of the mind, an aspect of the mind, then this and would have been entirely redundant. The mind and the individual ego would have been absolutely synonymous, as Professor Mishra emphasized, highlighted upon. But I was not using the English phrase individual ego to mean simply the ahankara, which is an aspect of the mind. I was using that English phrase for jiva. And jiva is not antakarana alone. It is either antakarana avachinna chaitanya or antakarana upahita chaitanya or avidya pratibimbita chaitanya. So there is a duality. Ahankara always involves a duality in it, which has been highlighted over and again by Shankara himself, by Panchapadikakaro Padmapadacharyo, by Prakashatmayoti in his Vivarana. This is the first point. The second point, we won't be able to, yes, time, very quickly. Yes, the second point is about the relationship.
You said that antakarana and manas, they are different.
Yes, yes, no.
Whereas Shankara himself has used that as
a I never said that antakarana and manas are different. If I said that, then I would not have used, in my presentation, antakarana and manas synonymously. To show the composite character of the antakarana, I have used the inference there I was using antakarana. Then to show the sadhitva, I used tanmano akuruta shruti. There I was using mano. Then again I said that all these kama sankalpa vichikitsa, they are all transformations of manas. There also I used the term mano, sarvang mano evo. So throughout my presentation, I used antakarana and manas interchangeably. And two terms can be used interchangeably if and only if they are synonymous. Otherwise, this change would have been nonsensical. Okay. And the third point is mainly soteriological. Now, and the akhandakara vritti. I have already said that Pramana Chaitanya is antakarana vritti abhivakta vishaya avachinna chaitanya. I couldn't use the Sanskrit term. This is the object consciousness as manifested by a transformation of the mind, the antakarana vritti. And before liberation, it is necessary to remove the covering of avidya, which can't be done by any transformation of avidya itself. It has to be done by an antakarana vritti, which is the akhandakara vritti, and the akhandakara vritti has for its object not pure consciousness. This is a very important point, not pure consciousness, but doita mithyatva upalakshita chaitanya. Okay, and akhandakara vritti removes the covering of avidya, and then only the sadhaka is liberated. So, antakarana is very important in Advaita soteriology, but the Advaita philosophers differ very bitterly among themselves regarding the process of liberation. Vivaranacharya and Bhamatikaro has fought tooth and nail over this point. Yeah. I can't go into that debate right now.
Thank you very much.
Can I have
No, because otherwise it will turn into a conversation just between the two of you. And what I'd like to do is give others a chance. Please. So this is now a moment for some other members of the dais, if they wish to ask a question.
Just to make announcements.
Yes.
That's all. Yeah. After the discussion, I have to make announcements.
Okay, very good. After the discussion. Are there any points?
And what about tea? I mean, one thing that I'm a little confused, and hopefully I'm not alone in this, is the way the word consciousness is used in this context. From the Buddhist perspective, when I hear the word consciousness, I'm thinking of vijnana, namshe, or sometimes just shepa. But here, I understand in the Samkhya tradition, consciousness is seen as unique to purusha, and purusha is kind of inactive. But then in the Advaita Vedanta, consciousness is seen as being part of the Brahma. So, but where, what exactly is the word consciousness actually being rendered as equivalent of? I mean, I can see mind as equivalent of manas. It has a problem. I can see ahamkara as sometimes being translated as the I maker or ego. I can understand that. But where is the word for consciousness in this? Chaitanya. That's the word, okay. Thank you. That's all I was looking for.
Consciousness is that which is prakasha swarupa, whose essence is self-revelation. It reveals itself. It is Swayam Jyoti Swarupa. But Swayam Jyoti, it is self-revealing. It reveals itself. That is the essential feature of consciousness in the Upanishads and in Advaita philosophy. In other philosophies, consciousness has been looked upon in other ways. For instance, a few days ago we had a seminar on Kashmir Soishavism, who looked upon consciousness as Prakasha Vimarsha Swarupo, which is an entirely different conception of consciousness. So different conceptions of consciousness were there in ancient India.
But just to follow up, but the Purusha is not self-revealing. It's not self-luminous, is it? Purusha is a consciousness, but it's in Samkhya, but it's not self-conscious. Is it self-luminous? It's self. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Any other questions? By the way, the back row people are not prevented from also asking questions or making.
Can I just
yes, a second? But I will first give, if there's anyone in the audience who would like to make a question on this point, yes, please come up to the microphone in the front. While you do that, I'm going to give Professor Mishra a quick response.
Dr. Rupa Bandopadhyaya, I just want, we could have used the word self in the title instead of ego. That won't make any problem, just a submission. You may keep that word also. Second, in the second slide, you say the Sanskrit term antahkarana literally means the internal organ or the internal instrument, while the term manana means the organ of the manana or reflection. They are different. Let there not be any discussion. But why my doubt came is because of this. One more thing I wanted to tell you about mind. Large discussion comes in Vichara Sagara, where this antakarana vritti and vritti as the modification of mind, and everything including liberation, jivan mukti, is a vritti, is being discussed, taking into consideration all the things. And you don't have to bring in ekajiva vada for doing this. Like, you don't have to. It is very simple. So, thank you.
Perhaps a defining characteristic of the mind is intelligence. Now, in artificial intelligence, we measure intelligence by how much something has learned or how fewer mistakes it is making. So my question to all of you is, in all these theories of the mind, where we talk of the buddhi, the chitta, and so forth, when we learn, what is it that is learning? Where is the learning stored? And how do we know that learning has transformed, in a sense, some fundamental quality within the consciousness? That's my question. That's
a good question. Would anyone want to take a stab at this?
Yes, learning also is very... I am not talking anything on AI, artificial intelligence, because I do not know about AI. I am not an AI person. I am not a software professional or an engineer. Now, the Indian philosophers, they also give very important place to learning. Learning always creates sanskara, which may or may not be translated as memory. And what does learning do? Learning, sanskara is placed in the self by the noyaikas. Learning some way adds to the knowledge of the self. And the Sangha, Yoga, and the Advaita Vedantins place sanskara in the antakarana or manas, and knowledge is stored in antakarana. Of course, antakarana accompanied by consciousness in some way or other. In Advaita Vedanta, it's reflected in Antokarana. In Shankha Yoga, consciousness is an absolutely different principle, which it is not the case in Advaita Vedanta, because Advaita Vedantins are monists. So learning creates sanskara, and that if learning is good learning, it will lead to the purification of the individual, leading to liberation. If it is bad learning, acquired from bad action and bad practices, that will take us away from liberation.
Yes, Swami.
First, about the artificial intelligence business. I think most of you know that there's a beautiful book by Roger Penrose called The Emperor's New Mind. He was arguing against strong AI. The question about artificial intelligence and learning itself, is the brain, human brain, thinking algorithmically? That's a fundamental question. You know, the algorithms in computer science. If the human brain is thinking algorithmically, then there's a particular logical sequence in which it is thinking, which means, is it a linear thinking or a non-linear thinking? And it is well known that human brain is not thinking linearly. The human brain is always non-linear in its thinking. And therefore, Roger Penrose argues there that human brain can never be replaced thoroughly and completely with artificial intelligence at any time. Now, the Advaita Vedanta, for example, says that you don't learn anything. That's a devastating statement. You unlearn what you have already learned, which means knowledge is already there within you, and you're uncovering that knowledge. There is not learning coming from outside and then in an empty vessel it is being put there. The vessel is already full of the ignorance you thought it was empty. And the uncovering of this already existing knowledge is what you call education. Swami Vivekananda is very emphatic about this. The Atman, the human soul, contains all knowledge. It is Jnana Swarupa. And it is because of ignorance that you are unable to learn anything. Nonsense. What you want to learn from outside is already there within you. By ignorance, you thought you did not know it. So Swami Vivekananda gives a simple example. Suppose you put a seed in the ground and the plant grows and a beautiful flower comes out. Are you saying that the flower is being created or the flower is being discovered? It is already there in the potential form. And that which is already potentially there, when it is manifested, you call it learning, you call it knowledge. There are another example which is given. When you make a beautiful statue from a stone, you are not making a statue, you are removing the non-statue from that stone, so that the statue is being manifested. The statue is already there. You remove those portions of the statue, which are not the statue. The removal of the non-statue from the stone reveals the statue which is already there within it. Therefore, when you say learning comes from outside, there are schools, of course, we say you get from Prakriti. Vedanta clearly says that you acquire nothing new from Prakriti, that we need to know is already there within you.
Thank you. I think we're almost at the end of the session, as in the case of Professor Joshi, I'd like to give Professor Bandopadhyaya the last word, but we'll make it short, and then there will be announcements immediately.
Yes.
Just one point I couldn't mention when I was responding to Swami Atmapriyanandaji's objection in the morning session. He rightly observed that the Turiya state is not superimposed. The Turiya state is identical with consciousness. But what does the Manduka Upanishad and the Manduka Upanishad Bhashya say in this regard? The Manduka Upanishad says, so I am Atma Chatushpat. And the Bhashya says, Karshapana Riva, Karshapana Iva na Gauriti, na Gauriva. That is, this Atma is Chatushpat, but this Padatva of Turiya is superimposed on the Turiya state. The Turiya state itself has nothing to do with superimposition. It is consciousness itself. But that we are looking upon it as a father of Atman, that Padatva is superimposed, but of because of course consciousness doesn't have any property. And that is a small observation.
Thank you. Now it's time for announcements.
So,
okay, this wraps up this session. There's now tea break until 3:25. So thank you all very much.